بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. Welcome dear brothers and sisters to the second session. For the person who doesn't perform salah, we have different issues within the main issue. The main issue is to leave the salah. He is not praying. So we have different issues. The first issue is he or does he leave salah for the denial of being obligatory? He denies that salah is obligatory, or for being lazy person? He says yes, I believe it is obligatory, but I become lazy to do it. So we have to differentiate. So this is firstly, when we discuss the issue of the person who doesn't perform salah, we have to first instance, we have to differentiate between the person who denies the obligation of salah and the person who is lazy to do salah. There is ijma' between scholars, consensus between scholars, that the person who denies the obligation of salah is a kafir, is not Muslim. Why he should be considered as a kafir? He doesn't believe in one of the pillars. Another answer? There is a term in the Islamic literature, it's called what is known necessarily by the religion or from the religion. Let's say al-ma'loom min al-deen bil-darura. What is known necessarily by being a Muslim? What is known necessarily by being a Muslim? God is one. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his messenger. Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the last messenger. Right? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is a messenger for all people. Salah is wajib. Zakah is wajib. So this is what is known by a Muslim, by necessarily known by a Muslim. That means all Muslims, just by being the nature or by being a Muslim, they know this thing, these things. And al-ma'lum min ad-din bid-darura, and this kind these judgments, whoever denies its obligation, or whoever denies the existence of this judgment, he shall not be considered as a Muslim. Whoever denies that God is not one, or that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not his messenger, or Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not his final messenger, or salah is not obligatory in Islam, or zakah is not obligatory in Islam, he shall not be considered as a Muslim. Why? Because he doesn't take the sources of Islam duly. Why? Because within all the sources of Islam, in the Quran and the Sunnah, we have dozens of verses and dozens of hadiths that say Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last messenger. Some people claim that they are Muslims, but they don't believe that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last messenger. They believe in him, in the last prophet, but they say he is not the last messenger. Who are these people? Not Shia. Qadiani. The Qadiani people, they say that they are Muslims, but they believe in a prophet after the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this prophet is a spy, the UK spy. So they believe in a prophet, whatever he is, even if he is a righteous person. So whatever his nature, they believe that there is a prophet after Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They don't believe in Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the final prophet and messenger. This is what we know, or this is what we call al-ma'loom min ad-deen bid-darura. What is necessarily known by all Muslims, that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the last messenger. So the person who denies a necessarily known fact by being a Muslim, that means he is not Muslim. The same for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is sent to all mankind, all people. The people who say the Prophet ﷺ was sent to the Arabs, or was sent to the people in Saudi Arabia, or in the Arab Peninsula, so also they are denying a fact that is necessarily known by being a Muslim. In Islam, in the Quran, you will find dozens of verses that saying the Prophet Muhammad was sent to the whole people, the mankind. Right? Within the Sunnah of Prophet Muhammad, you will find dozens of hadith that says that the Prophet Muhammad himself said, I was sent to the mankind, the whole people. So in this case, this person denies a certain conceptual fact in Islam. Let's say, without this fact, then a person may not be following what Islam is, what Islam truly is. Let's say, this person, is he fully ignorant about Islam, or he is knowing about these things? Let's say, a person who denies the Salah, or a person who denies that Muhammad is the Prophet for all people. This person is one of two persons. Either he is just new to Islam, he is fully ignorant about what Islam is, or he know exactly what Islam is, but he denies this. So these are two persons. So let's say, let's take the example of Salah. Let's not take more details. Let's say the example of Salah. What is the judgment of the person who denies or who doesn't perform Salah? Firstly, is he denying the Salah itself being obligatory, or being a lazy person? He accepts and he believes in the obligation of Salah, but he is lazy to do it. So this is what the first question. So if we say he denying the Salah being obligatory, we cannot say simultaneously that he is a kafir. We have to differentiate between two persons. The person who is fully ignorant about Islam, let's say one example is the person who just took the shahada. He believes that that there is no God but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He believes that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the messenger of Allah, is the last messenger of Allah. Just he believed in so, and then he recited the shahada. He said the shahada. He didn't believe anything. He didn't know anything about Salah. So once we say to him that there are five obligatory prayer, he may say, why five obligatory prayer? We can do three. Why prayer is obligatory? Out of question, out of being fully ignorant about what is Salah in Islam. So this person, we cannot say he is a kafir. He's just a Muslim now. He just came from kufr now. So in this case, we have to inform him about what is Salah, what is the position of Salah in Islam, what is the judgment of Salah in Islam, as long as he is following Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as long as he believes in the Quran as the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or as the kalam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we have to cite from the Quran the position of Salah, the command of Salah, and so on and forth. So we have to inform him about the position of Salah before we judge. And for the other person who is, for example, who is raised between the Muslim community, even if he is an Arab, but he say Salah is not obligatory, then we judge this person just denied what is necessarily known by being a Muslim. So imagine the difference. So we have to be specific, be very specific within the ahkam, or the judgment, or that this person is so and forth, this person is so and forth. And for the next level, we as individual persons don't have the authority to stamp the final judgment over this person. We don't have these stamps. This person is khalas kafir, he is in the hellfire, and this person is a believer. We as individual persons don't have the authority to label the people. The authority lies in the scope of judiciary or judgment or qada in Islam. So the qadi is the person who will label this person whether he is a kafir or no, not the individual Muslims. The qadi or the person who is in authority. So these labels, these judgments are not left to the individuals, because it is very important, it's very critical. Person maybe in Islam or out the fold of Islam, this is very critical issue. So it is not left to the people or the individuals, because there is biases, or in most cases there is biases between people, individuals in general. So the person who shall judge that this person is a kafir or this person is a Muslim is the judge himself, is the qadi himself. But in general, we say as individuals, the person who denies the obligation of salah is a kafir. For general, we cannot be specific in this case. We cannot say that so and so person is a kafir right away. We cannot say this, okay? But we, in general, as the scholar said, the person who is denying the obligation of salah, the person who is denying the prophethood of Muhammad, the person who is denying that Prophet Muhammad is the last messenger, the person who is denying the obligation of zakah, or so and forth, he shall be not Muslim. So it is not related to salah. It may come, inshallah, as we will see, inshallah, as we see, it may come to zakah also. It may come to the pillars of Islam, the practical pillars of Islam, Salah, Zakah, Siyam, and Hajj, and so on and so forth.
But Iman, the pillars of Iman also, if they disbelieve or they deny?
Same. This rule, Al-Ma'lum Min Ad-Din Bid-Darura, or what is necessary known by being a Muslim, is in the pillars of faith and in the pillars of Islam as well. The person who denies the one of the messengers, for example, is the same. The person who denies the prophethood of Isa alayhi salam or Musa alayhi salam is the same. He is the same. By being a Muslim, necessarily you believe that Isa is a messenger, Musa is a messenger, and so on and forth. Isa has the Injil, or Musa has the Torah, and so on and forth. Any person who denies this kind of facts shall not be considered as Muslim if he is aware about what he says. But if he is just new about Islam or completely ignorant about Islam, we have to inform him first. And this is just an advice. Our himma, our determination, our intention is to educate the people, not to label the people. Because unfortunately, we or most of us, unfortunately, just have the patience to label the person directly. And the patient should be directed to educate the person directly, not to label the person. Whether on the level of being a Muslim or kafir, or on the level of being Sunni or Mubtadi', or have a Sunnah, or following the Sunnah, or following the Bid'ah. We shall not be tolerant about the Bid'ah, but we have to deal with the manner, with it according to the best manner. According to the best manner is not to say this is bid'ah and this is mubtada and I will not communicate with him, for example. The best manner is to educate him first. He is your brother. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, لا يؤمن أحدكم حتى يحب لأخيه ما يحب لنفسه. The belief of you shall not be complete, shall not be perfect, except you love for your brother what you love for yourself. That means, just ask yourself, or ask the person who is just hastening to take the people or consider the people disbelievers or kafirs, or consider the people so and forth. Just ask yourself, is it what you love for yourself or what you love for yourself or no? What you love for yourself is to being educated, is to being informed, is to have the excuses. By doing anything or by believing in anything. So that's the same for us. We have to love for our brothers and sisters the same, to being excused, to being educated, to being informed, and so on and so forth, before we judge. And the judgment, let the judgment be the scholars and to the judges. You, according to your best, you advise. And that's it. And leave the rest. you advise, you educate, you tell the person about the truth, about the sunnah, about the haqq, and so on and forth, and leave the rest. Don't make yourself busy with the rest, because the rest is not yours. The rest, the guidance, whether from kufr to Islam or from bid'ah to sunnah, the guidance is not yours. The guidance is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala only. The person himself, just in the English proverb, put yourself in his shoes. Just put yourself in his shoes. Once you see a person is committing an evil of an act of disbelief, for example, just put yourself in his shoes, or say or witness in your within yourself the bless of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the ni'mah or the guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he provided you. The same for the bliss of being attached to the scholars, attached knowing the ilm, or knowing the sciences of Sharia, and so on and forth. Just witness within yourself all these blessings before you say that this person is so on force. Once you witnessed the ni'mah, the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala within yourself, that means you will be eager to convey it to your brother or to your sister. So we say that within the scope of judgments, we say the patience should be to the himmah, the determination, the inclination should be to inform and educate the people, not to label them. But we have, in general, we have to study that the person who say so and forth, or the person who do so and forth, maybe committing a bid'ah or commit an act of bid'ah. This is a kind of theoretical study. This is not, we don't study to label the people or to say that so-and-so is so-and-so. No. We study to educate ourselves, to remove the ignorance from ourselves, and to educate our brothers who are falling in an act of bid'ah, or an act of kufr. We study to inform them, not to label them. So the person who denies the salah, or the person who doesn't offer the salah, once he doesn't offer the salah out of ignorance, is different from out of denial. And the out of denial is different from the person who is just completely ignorant about Islam, or he just embraces Islam, from the person who has been raised within a Muslim community, or specifically for an Arab community, because he has the access directly to the Quran and the Sunnah. The person who doesn't perform salah out of laziness, this is the next issue. Out of if denial, khalas, we know. Out of laziness, is he kafir? Completely out of Islam or no? Why no? Yes. Yes. All of you agreed on with the brother?
Yeah, it's not, he doesn't, I mean, he still believes. It's just that he's just lazy.
Say, imagine a person, once he became an adult, for 15 years, 20 years, he's saying that La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, but he never ever prayed one rak'ah. Imagine this person. Is he a Muslim or no? Just for 10 years, 15 years, 20 years, he just say, I am a Muslim, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. But he never ever prayed for one rak'ah. Imagine another person who is, throughout his life, he may pray for 2 days and leave prayer for 1 month. May pray for 1 week and leave prayer for another week. And imagine a person who just left or missed one prayer out of laziness. Are they the same? So the let's say the issue of the person who deny or who doesn't perform salah out of laziness, is it the same condition or is it the same situation to say this person is so and false, and to make the persons who left salah for 20 years completely for 20 years with the person who is just making one salah and missing another salah, are they the same in judgment? Yeah, when the people or when the scholars say the person who doesn't perform salah out of laziness, then we have to consider the meaning of this issue according to different scholars. So maybe one scholar say that the person who doesn't perform salah out of laziness, and he just imagine in his mind the person who doesn't perform salah at all. Or another scholar, he may say that the person who doesn't perform salah, he may have the image of the person who may perform salah for one day and leave salah for 20 days or 1 month and so on and forth. So we have to be specific also. In the issues of fiqh in general, we have to be very specific. Why? Because you might see it is one issue, but in reality, in fact, they are 10 issues. Why? Because of different considerations, different situations, different conditions, different aspects. Some scholar may see the issue from one aspect, some other scholar may see the issue from another aspect. Okay? For the person who leaves the salah completely, we have a strong differentiation between scholars. That some people say he is a kafir out of Islam directly, and some others says he is not a kafir, but he is committing a sin that is worse than or more evil than the killing the innocent person or committing adultery or so and forth or major sins. So the sin of leaving salah is a major sin, is one of the major sin. It's just under the disbelief. So, and this is the chosen opinion, inshallah, that the person, as long as he say that I believe in salah as an obligation, as long as he doesn't deny the salah as an obligation, that means he is still in the category of being a Muslim. But for Allah's decision is another issue. He may not be a Muslim for Allah's decision, but we cannot say he is not a Muslim according to our decision. But in any case, there are narrations about the Prophet ﷺ that said that the person who leaves salah or who doesn't perform salah is a kafir. And even we have stresses from the Prophet ﷺ himself that the covenant between or the criterion between us and them, us means the Muslims, the Prophet ﷺ say the criterion between us as Muslims and them, the people of the book or the disbelievers, is the salah. Whoever leaves the salah, he shall be a disbeliever. In general, so we have narrations that address the people who doesn't perform salah or who don't perform the salah as disbelievers generally. But we have also other narrations which indicate that this disbelief is not the disbelief that is opposite to Islam. That this belief is what we say. Kufr duna kufr, or the lesser disbelief, or kufr asghar. If you study the concepts of aqidah, you will differentiate between what's kufr asghar, what's kufr akbar, what is shirk asghar, what's shirk akbar, major shirk and minor shirk, major kufr and minor kufr. So the people or the scholars majority of scholars said it is not a major kufr or a major shirk. Leaving salah out of laziness is not a kind of major shirk or major kufr, but it is a minor kufr or a minor shirk. So this is according to the majority of scholars. But we have, if we consider the madhabs, we have the Hanbali madhab who say it is major shirk and major kufr according to the narrations from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But the majority of scholars said it is the minor one. But this doesn't, of course, make the issue of leaving salah as all other sins. Because if we consider the position of salah, and we consider the narrations of leaving salah that addresses the people who leave salah, we will find it is worse than anything or any kind of sin, except the shirk. If we say salah is not a major shirk, but if we consider salah from another perspective, if we consider salah as major shirk, that means it's khalas, is out of Islam. But according to the majority of scholars, we will consider salah from the second perspective as it minor shirk, but it is worse than any other sin or any other major sin. What is the highest major sin you could imagine? It is to kill an innocent person. Leaving salah is worse than killing an innocent person, according to Ibn al-Qayyim rahimahullah and other scholars. So we say it is not a major shirk, but it doesn't mean it is a simple sin. It is the most major sin in the categories, within the categories of sins itself.
Sheikh, if someone who reverts to a Muslim and take a shahada, but they also miss their prayers, like if I take the hadith from the narration, if it's out of Islam, there's the shahada only once, right? Only you repent. Is that enough? We don't have to take another, context of out of Islam. Does that mean you're not a Muslim?
The person who just embraced Islam,
yeah,
and then missed the salah.
Yeah, like 4 years, and then like, if the context of hadith said you are already out of Islam.
4 years and so on forth. We have to recall the issue of leaving the salah out of negligence or out of denial. So we said that the person who is new Muslim doesn't have the fact of salah as one of the necessary pillars in Islam or judgments in Islam. That means he is out of ignorance, doesn't pray. For example, for 1 year, for 5 years, it is the same. It is the same. Once he become aware about Islam, that means he is required to study about Islam. And this study about Islam is a mutual obligation between him and between the people who surrounding him. For example, it is a mutual obligation between him as an individual person and the community, and the community of Muslims in general. Let's say a person who embraced Islam within the community, a Muslim community, and the Muslim community didn't inform him about anything else except he is recited shahada and that's it. Here, the blame should be for the community more than him. Why? Because he already changed his religion. And you know, and every person who is a revert know exactly what does it mean to change the religion. So he already chosen the difficult step of changing his religion. So he is ready to do anything else, to pray, to cover her head, and so on and so forth, because all of these issues are just minor issues in comparison to changing the religion itself. So the person who is a revert took already the difficult step of changing his religion. So the responsibility is upon the community to tell him that this is Islam, this is from Islam, this is not from Islam. This is obligation in Islam, this is not obligation in Islam, and so on and so forth. And that's why it is recommended for the person who embraces Islam, then it's recommended for us to just being his alternative people, because once he is not Muslim, he have certain friends, family, and so on and forth, and all of them just calling him back to this belief. And then he chose the decision already. He decided to be a Muslim. He decided to be a servant to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to follow the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What's the next step? The next step is to know about Islam, to know more about Islam. What are the obligations of Islam? The next step, this step should be fulfilled by the community around him. Because he alone, maybe we witnessed many brothers and sisters who embraced Islam alone by their own research, especially online research. We witnessed many brothers and sisters by just own research. They have questions, they researched online, debates and YouTube about Islam and books and so on and forth. Finally, they took Shahada online by their own research. But what's next? Who will inform them about Islam? How can we make sure about the correct teachings of Islam? Maybe he or she meet online also, or even in her community or his community, a person who is a Shia or a person who is Qadiani, who claims to be a Muslim, or a person who is Qurani, who neglects the Salah at all. So it is our necessary more than his necessary. So the person who is a new Muslim, still in the category of ignorant people about Islam, unless somebody teaches him or educates him about the position of Salah and the position of other obligations in Islam as well. So the next issue after being informed about the obligation of Salah and different cases of Salah being obligatory or not obligatory, we will study the times of Salah. And the times of Salah, we will focus on the obligatory prayers. And we have also the non-obligatory prayers or voluntary prayers which can be addressed inshallah within the section of special prayers. So when we study the witr prayer, we will say the time of the witr prayer is so and forth. When we study the Eid prayer, we will say its time is so and forth. So in times, in this issue, we will study the obligatory prayers, five obligatory prayers. And for each time of these obligatory prayers, we have two categories. The first category is obligatory time and recommended time. In this time, it is obligatory to do the Salah, or in this time, it is recommended to do Salah. For example, for Salah of Zuhr, or Salah of Asr, or Salah of Maghrib, or Salah of Isha, all of these salawat have different times, in which certain time is obligation and certain time is recommended. And even for some times, like Asr, for example, we have three categories of time: recommended, optional, and obligatory. So what are the times of each Salah? Firstly, we can just outline the times of Salah in general, outline the times of Salat al-Dhuhr, outline the time of Salat al-Asr, outline the time of Salat al-Maghrib, outline of Salat al-Isha, outline of Salat al-Subh or Fajr. And then after outlining the whole time, we can specify or we can categorize this time to this portion of time is obligation, or this portion of time is recommended, and this portion of time is optional, and so on and forth. So first of all, what are the outlines, general outlines of Salatul Fajr? Salatul Subh or Salatul Fajr. What is the general outline of Salah, whether it is recommended or wajib? No, we know Fajr is wajib. The Salah itself is wajib. We say about the time itself. within the time of Fajr, we find some certain time is it is wajib to do Fajr now, and certain time it is recommended to do Fajr in this time. Yes, excellent, excellent. So, let's say firstly, what is the time of Fajr? What's the time of Fajr? 5:50. Not 5:50.
The dawn breaks with the first light.
Yeah. From the first light of dawn until
sunrise.
Until sunrise. So this is the outline, the general outline of Fajr time. From the first or the starting point of dawn up until sunrise. So sunrise is not included in the Fajr. Okay, the time of sunrise is not included in the time of Fajr until sunrise. So this is the outline of Fajr. Okay, for Dhuhr, what is the outline of Dhuhr? Not by the shadow, just general outline, because shadow may be difficult.
Midday
or once that the sun starts to move from the zenith of the sky, just start to move, then this is the time of Zuhr until the time of Asr. let's be simple, until the time of Asr, okay? Until the time of Asr, in which the shadow is doubled. The time of Asr is when the shadow is doubled until the sunset of Maghrib, until sunset. So in general, the outlines in general, the Fajr time from the dawn, starting point of dawn until sunrise, the Dhuhr time from the sun moves from the zenith of the sky until Asr time, and Asr time until sunset. Sunset is not included. And Maghrib time from sunset, that means after sunset directly until the disappearance of toilet, or let's say until Isha time. Okay, let's be it will be difficult to figure it out by the shadow or by the toilet and so on and forth. Yes, so until Isha time. And Isha time, the outline, the general outline of Isha time, until Subuh in one opinion and until midnight in the other opinion. Until midnight in the other opinion. So these are the general outlines of the five obligatory prayers. Within each outline, we have categorizations. We have this time is obligatory, this time is recommended, and this time is optional. And of course, this is based on the opinion that says that the time of Salah or the time of performing Salah is from the starting point of the time until the ending point of the time. According to this opinion, Salah is not obligatory immediately once the sun moves from the zenith of the sky. That means Salah is immediately obligatory? No, we don't say this. We say that the Salah obligatory in between, yani that from the starting point of the time until the other time comes, or the end of time. So for example, for Subh, we said that the Subh begins from the dawn, from the starting point of dawn, the first glimpse of light in the horizon until before sunrise, just before sunrise. If we categorize this timeline or this outline, we will find that we have two options or two opinions of scholars. Some scholars said it is preferred, it is recommended to pray Subh immediately once the dawn comes That means at the starting point of Subh. And some other scholars said it is recommended to do Isfar or to pray the Subh in the after maybe like 30 minutes or 45 minutes from the time. So these are two opinions. And the most strong opinion is to do the Subh once the Subh comes, or once the Fajr comes, or once the dawn comes. So this is the recommended time. The optional time from after this time, from after the first 20 minutes or 30 minutes until just before sunrise, we'll say it by minutes because it is easier, until before sunrise by 5 minutes. And the 5 minutes before sunrise, it is obligatory. So the one who didn't pray Subh until before sunrise, 5 minutes, that means this time is obligatory for him to do Salah. Why? Because if he didn't perform the Salah in this time, he will miss the Salah. He will miss the obligation. And the obligation is to do the Salah within the specific time, selected time, from dawn to sunrise, or until before sunrise. So this is a selected time. It is obligatory to do the Salah within this time. At the beginning, it is recommended. In between, it is optional. And just before sunrise, it is obligatory to do it immediately. What is exactly the duration? The duration is the same duration for you to do 2 units. So for example, for Fajr, what is the obligatory time before sunrise? It is the same time in which you do 2 units, because Fajr is 2 units. You have to pray the 2 units within the time. You have to finish the 2 units before sunrise, so that this period is the obligatory period. Let's say in our modern measurement, let's say it is 5 minutes. So this is the categorization. So the first 15 to 20 minutes, it is recommended to do Fajr in this time, which is what the masajid is doing. They say this is 10 minutes for Sunnah prayer, and then they do the Iqamah, which is the correct opinion of the recommended time for prayer. And then after this time, we have a period for maybe 45 minutes or 50 minutes in between this period and before the obligatory time. And we have finally, or before the end of time, we have 5 minutes for the the obligatory prayer. Yes, yes. So this is for Fajr. And for Zuhr, it is the same. We have recommended, we have optional, we have obligatory time. Optional, that means if you do it, it's okay. It will be sufficient for you. But the recommended, the sunnah, is to do it in this specific time. For Zuhr, for example, it is recommended to hasten to do the Zuhr time. It is recommended to pray Zuhr immediately in the starting point of the time of Zuhr. And the optional time, it is the same as Fajr exactly. And the optional time is after the recommended, or until before Asr time, by the duration in which you can pray 4 units within the time. And then this duration, let's say 7 minutes, you can pray 4 units. Let's say 7 minutes, 8 minutes before Asr. This is the obligatory time to pray Zuhr.
Same time, the recommended between the first 10-20 minutes.
Yes, for Fajr and Zuhr, the recommended time to do the Salah is at the starting point of the time itself. Except for Aisha, and according to some scholars, except for Fajr also. So, but we say that what is the judgment, our opinion, the chosen opinion is to pray Fajr immediately. This is recommended. For Aisha, it is recommended to delay the prayer as long as you fulfill certain conditions. For example, you are for men. For example, for men, if you still in a congregation and you all agree to delay the Isha until before midnight, then it is recommended to do Isha at this time. This is the Sunnah of Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam delayed Isha at certain night, and they said, "I wish to pray Isha every day in this time." It is recommended to do this, to do Isha in this time, as we'll see, inshallah. So for Asr, Asr also has three times. The first time is recommended, yes. The first time is recommended, the second time is optional, and the third time is obligatory. But we will include, as the scholar said, we will include a makruh time or dislike time just before the obligatory time. The obligatory time, when the sun becomes yellow. When the sun becomes yellow, that means you have to pray Asr, but it is disliked to delay Asr until this time. It may be like 30 minutes before Maghrib or so, 30 minutes before Maghrib. And the obligatory time is just also 8 minutes to 9 minutes just before sunset. So this is the Asr. You are recommended time as the beginning of time of Asr. And then from this time until the sun becomes yellow, then it is optional to do Asr in this time. Once the sun becomes yellow, that means it is disliked to do Asr, but you have to do it. And then if all this khalas finish and you have 10 minutes to sunset, that means it's obligatory upon you to do Asr. Of course, it is disliked to delay Asr at this time, but you have to perform it before the time of Maghrib, before the sunset. So this is the Asr. But in general, it also can be divided, its time can be divided to recommended, optional, and obligatory.
So Ustaz, just now you mentioned it's already turned yellow, means it's already makruh, right?
Yes.
Okay, so meaning the obligatory is already towards the end of the makruh time, right?
Yes. Yes. So we say makruh time, the time of the Asr, which is considered as makruh, it is the time in which the sun is yellow. According to some narrations, the Prophet ﷺ criticizes the people who delay Asr until the sun becomes yellow. And he said that it is an indication for hypocrisy and so on and forth. So they delay until the sun becomes yellow and then just quickly do the salam. So it is an indication that once the sun becomes yellow, it is disliked to delay Asr until this time, but you have to do the prayer. You have to perform the prayer. It is delayed until, or it is detestable or disliked until the obligatory time in which you cannot pray Asr, the full time, the four units of Asr, until before the Maghrib unit. So this is in this case, you have to do the four units, even if it is just before the sunset.
So the obligatory is wajib, because you have to perform the Asr.
Yes.
But it's a dislike time
is
to perform it, because you should perform it early.
Yes. Yes. Just to consider the terms recommended, optional, disliked, or obligatory, you have to consider the time, not the salah itself. The time. It is recommended to do salah in this time. It is optional to do salah in this time. It is disliked to do salah in this time, or it is obligatory to do salah in this time. So you have to consider the time itself, not the salah.
When the shadow of an object is equal to the object explaining.
We said that we have to be simple, more simple, because we will not measure our shadows nowadays. Nowadays, we don't have to measure our shadows. We have the times, alhamdulillah, by minute, yani by hour and by minutes, which is more specific than our measurements. So it is recommended for all of us to rely on the taqwim, not for the measurements of the sun. Because if I asked any one of you, how could you know that the sun is in the middle of zenith? How could you know? You don't know. For the Fajr time, how could you know that this is the dawn? It is very, it's very difficult for all of us. Why? Because we are not living in the desert. It is very difficult to identify the time of Fajr within the cities. Because of the light. You will not be able to see the light of Fajr, the first light of Fajr. In this case, we say, don't measure by observing or seeing the light of Fajr or the movement of the sun from the zenith or for the shadow or for the twilight for Maghrib and Isha. Just rely on the taqwim. Okay? For Maghrib time, the recommended time is? For Maghrib?
Immediately.
Excellent. For optional? After this time, up until before Isha? By 7 minutes to 8 minutes, and so on and so forth. And the obligatory time is just before Isha by 7 to 8 minutes. For Isha, we have a major differentiation between scholars, whether it is its time until Fajr or its time until midnight, which is a big difference if we say it is until Fajr or it is until midnight. And in this case, even I choose the opinion in which the Isha is until Fajr. But we have to be curious, and we have let's say the acts of worship, as Sheikh Islam Taymiyyah said, rahimahullah, that the acts of worship is the most acts that worthy of being curious. And we have to be curious about the time to the extent that although we believe that Isha is until Fajr, we have to be cautious and say we will perform Isha in the agreed time. The agreed time is until midnight. Even if we know or if we consider the opinion of scholar, it is correct to delay Isha until just before Fajr, which is strong opinion. So for the first opinion, Isha, three times. Optional time is the first time. The recommended time is around midnight, and optional time again until just before Fajr. No, of course no. For the one who is able to do so, because many of people sleep after Isha directly. So they have to perform Isha before they sleep. As the Prophet ﷺ was described, that he hates or he disliked to sleep before Isha time. And he disliked to speak after Isha, after praying Isha. Just sleep and pray and sleep. So this is about the Prophet ﷺ. In any case, this is the categorization of Siyam. Most of us have to know the outline, the general outline of the time, and to pray time immediately. Because all of the prayers, except for Isha, it is recommended to pray time immediately in the first first 15 to 20 minutes of time. This is the recommended time to do Zuhr and to do Fajr and to do Asr and to Maghrib. Aisha, according to certain this opinion, that it is recommended to do the Aisha around midnight. But if you will sleep before this, of course you have to do Aisha or you have to perform the Aisha. The obligatory time of Aisha will differ according to the opinion also, whether it is just before midnight or just before Fajr. So the obligatory time, according to the chosen opinion, will be 10 minutes before Fajr, inshallah.
So does it mean that the Prophet always prays near midnight for the Isha prayers?
Yes.
Does it mean that the Prophet always prays
Isha prayers? Not always, but he prayed around midnight and said that I wish to pray the Isha for according to this time. And I wish to pray Isha around midnight every day. But of course it was difficult because, as we said, it is conditioned that we already have the congregation, all of us will not sleep, and so on, for some conditions. But in any case, even in the narration itself, Umar radiallahu anhu said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, called the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, O Messenger of Allah, prayer, women and children slept in the masjid. So it is recommended as long as we are all agree on this delay of Isha. Otherwise, we have to do Isha at the beginning of time. Yes.
What is the reason for this delay?
I don't know.
Is there any evidence that mentioning at the before Fajr? Is there any evidence? I mean, of course there is evidence, but what is the evidence?
There is absence of evidence for both opinions. So no opinion said it is a strictly nas or hadith say that it is before Fajr or before midnight. They have some considerations. They have some reasoning of different opinions, but we don't want to give you details about different opinions. Just say that the chosen opinion is Aisha is until Fajr, according to the scholars.
Is that the time of midnight is according to the opinion of Imam Ahmad, that is between Fajr and Maghrib?
No, midnight according to midnight is not 12 a.m. in the current time. In the current time, they say midnight is 12 a.m. But it is not midnight according to the correct consideration of Sharia. The correct consideration of Sharia says that Maghrib is the first of Layl, of night, and Fajr is the last of night. In between, you have to divide the time in between. So midnight is exactly in between the time of Maghrib and the time of Fajr. So inshallah, next time inshallah we'll continue. Jazakumullahu khairan, barakallahu feekum, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.